I'm Victoria Reinhardt, Ramsey County Commissioner, and I chair the Rushline Corridor Task Force, and want to welcome you here tonight. We do have some other elected officials in the audience, and I'm going to try to do my best. I know City Council Member Brian Belial was here. There we go. It's like, I knew you were here. Wiper Lake, the Wiper Lake Mayor Joe Emerson, Mayor Nora Slawick, and I'll be introducing her and talking a little bit more. We have Metropolitan Council Member Sandy Rummel is here. Oh, and Representative Peter Fisher is here. I know that tonight is very busy for everyone, so I'm really glad that you were able to make it here tonight. Did I miss any elected officials? Bob, he was here, but... Pardon me? Yes, Bob Kermes from White Bear Township. So, I wanted to, actually before I get started, I do want to, again, recognize Mayor Nora Slawick. There is a lot of things going on tonight, and Mayor Slawick was at the event, the open house last night. I was in Hugo and last night. But unfortunately, we have to leave to get into another meeting, and I know others have different things as well. Ramsey County League of Local Governments, and there's all kinds of things going on tonight. So apologize and that we do have to leave early. If you have questions for me, as the county commissioner representing Maplewood, North St. Paul, Wiper Lake, and the Hillcrest neighborhood in St. Paul, or Mayor Slawick, please just reach out to us, and again, apologize for having to leave early. So what you're going to hear tonight, and the reason that Dan is standing like this close to me, we're going to have a short presentation, and this is being videoed for GTN, and will be distributed actually along the corridor so that we can get as much input and be as transparent as possible. And so, but he's got the microphone, so he's going to be right there. And then most of the presentation is actually his anyway. I wanted to tell you, as chair of the task force, that we are very early in this process. And you will see this after the presentation. You'll immediately go back to all of these different areas, and we have staff. If they have a Rushline task force name tag, you can ask them questions about different things here. But we're very early in this process. And so as far as some of the specific answers about where will the route go, where are the stations going to be, what modes are going to be put into play here, we don't have answers, excuse me, to that at this point. We wanted to make sure that we got input early. And Dan will go through what this process is when the decision points are made. The Policy Advisory Committee is of Rushline is a separate organization, and they will be making decisions on the locally preferred alternative, and you'll hear about all of these different steps. But please bear in mind, excuse me, that we are very early in this process for a very important reason, and that is we want to get your input. We've got some, and you'll see when you look at the maps that we have, the things that are in purple are things that we have heard from the meetings and things that we've had already. We're trying to reach out in every possible way we can, including ways that I really don't understand, like the social media. I don't know how to tweet, I'm sorry. I've got a Twitter account, but I don't know how to tweet. But, you know, we're trying to make sure that we get as much information as possible and input. And that means positive, negative, concerns, solutions that you're thinking would work. Anything that you can give to us is going to help the Policy Advisory Committee and the task force and everybody along this line understand what this could and or should look like. So it doesn't matter what type of input, just please get it to us. And you'll see that there are many different ways to do that as well. So with that, again, at the end of this, at the end of the presentation, it's about 15 minutes or so, then we have all of these different parts that are covered in the presentation. But I know that people have specific questions, and you can talk to each other, and you can hopefully put your where you live, work, where you want to go onto the map if you're so willing to do so. The routes are over here. There's a lot of information here. And I guess I will end with the fact that it is also, we're taking this information, a lot of it's on the website right now. But as we get the input, we make sure that we summarize that and get that onto the website as well. So again, the transparency and trying to make sure that we get as much input as possible is what we're here for tonight. And I just want to say thank you for being here. A great turnout. And it has been a great turnout at both of the previous open houses as well. Again, bear in mind, this is not by any means the only place to provide that input. This is just one of the other settings that we have to get input. So thank you and enjoy the evening. And you know, all the folks that are on the task force and on the policy advisory committee are available to, you know, by contacting us through the website if you have specific questions for us. Thank you.
Okay, I will start, and Commissioner Reinhart said, she's given me 15 minutes to talk here. And this, Commissioner Reinhart says, this is our first time, this is our actual third night. Tuesday night, we're up in Hugo at the City Hall. Last night, we're in St. Paul at the Duluth Case Rec Center, and tonight we're here, and we're going to be coming back in June with some more information, and I'll be going over that momentarily. So really, why are we here tonight is really to get you up to speed on the project, what we've been doing since we last had open houses in May, at the end of May of last year. We've been doing a lot of work on the project, and most of that, it has to deal with what are the needs in the core, what is the purpose of the project that we're trying to build here or look at. And then really, the last bullet is listening to you. We really want to listen to you, and that's why after this presentation, we'd like to talk to you one-on-one in groups. I think we've already been doing that a lot already, but we'll continue to do that to at least 7, and if you want to stay later, we can try to stay later as well, and too. So to start with, this map kind of shows where we started with. In 2008 and 2009, Ramsey County Regional Railroad Authority completed an alternatives analysis, and the two lines that came out of that, out of about 10 to 12 different alternatives that we looked at that made the most sense, was the blue line, which is from Union Depot up 35E to 35 to Forest Lake, a more of a BRT or a bus rapid transit mode. The other from Union Depot, the yellow line, goes up the Ramsey County right-of-way, or the Bruce Rento Trail, and it's in White Bear Lake. So this is what we started with, because that was what came out in 2009. That's what we brought in May to you. So we've been doing a lot of work since that time after listening to everybody in May at those open houses, as well as throughout the whole engagement process. So we're right now in this sort of gumball machine of a funnel is we're going to be doing some evaluation on three tiers. The first one that we're, and this is really what we're doing tonight, is we have a universe of alternatives for alignments or roadways or trails that a transit investment can be on, and also looking at different modes. So over the next couple months and coming back to you in June, we're going to be looking at what makes the most sense and what should be almost on a pass-fail. Does it pass? Should it continue on at a real qualitative level, or do we just fail it and set it aside? Then, starting in June, after we come back out, we'll be starting to do the second tier, a detailed evaluation, really getting into those questions that you have right now. How much is it going to cost to build it? How much is it going to operate it? Who's going to be funding it? How many people are going to be riding it? Where are the stations going to be? What sort of economic development is going to be there? Whose houses are going to be impacted? What businesses are going to be impacted? So that's what we'll be doing there. And at the end, when we hit probably the end of this year, around between Thanksgiving and Christmas, we will be refining what we call a locally preferred alternative. And it truly is a local alternative. That's why we're here tonight, to listen to you. The whole implementation process, so right now, we are right in this area here, and usually this takes about 2 to 3 years to do this pre-project development. Really what we're trying to do is do detailed analysis, initiate environmental studies, and then really identify that alternative. The next step, if we have an alternative, is really to look at that project development. Is moving it forward into project development, doing a true environmental review, further adopting the alternative, then engineering, then construction. So from this point, which we began in 2014, until possible construction and operation, you're looking at somewhere between about 10 to 12 years to do that. So what we've done so far, these are from the time that we started the project in April of last year until tonight. all the different meetings and community events and presentations and pop-up displays and mini open houses. And so now we're into our second round of open houses now. And I think what's more important is we've done a lot of work here locally in Maplewood and St. Paul, and even going up into White Bear Lake. We've done walking tours of the trail. I think two or three walking tours of the trail. We've gone to different market fests up in White Bear Lake. We've gone to the White Bear Avenue parade. We've really tried to reach out at a real local level. And really, these are the other things that Commissioner Reinhardt had mentioned that she doesn't know much about, the website, the tweeting, the other social media and everything, but there's different ways of trying to get on to get information. I think the email is an important one, so if you have an email, definitely give us that, and we can get you information about what we're doing and when we're gonna be in your neighborhood and the next open houses and everything like that. Additionally, we can also text you when these open houses are occurring too. If you have a cell phone and can accept text, we can do that too. So there's many ways of trying to get involved. So to kind of talk about the work that we've been doing from starting in June of last year until now, and really trying to find out what the purpose of the project is and really trying to dig down into that. And really, the overall purpose is to provide transit service that satisfies the long-term regional mobility and accessibility needs for business and the traveling public. And that long-term really is out to about 2040. We're really looking at not just in 5 years, not just in 10, but really looking long-term out into that. And then finally, also is catalyzing sustainable development within this study area, within the corridor that you've been looking at the maps there too. So further on with that, we take that project purpose and we say, so what are the needs? Why are we doing this? You know, what really is impacting for to make an investment in transit or something in this corridor? And there's really four major project needs. I'll go through those one at a time. The first need is sustainable growth and development. And all these graphics and everything are all in the back of the room. So if you wanted to spend more time in looking at them, you could, or ask us questions. From 2010 to 2040, population is forecasted to grow just in this corridor by 24%. So from about 445,000 to 555,000 people. So there's a lot of growth that's gonna be occurring in that. And this data comes from the Metropolitan Council and from the US Census. Additionally, employment is increasing. As you can see, about 30% increase in employment in this corridor as well in that 30-year time frame that we're trying to. Additionally, that population and employment growth will occur in different portions of the corridor. You can kind of see the municipalities, St. Paul, Hugo, Forest Lake, all have major changes in population in the plus range. So in population in St. Paul, you're looking at about a 50,000 person. Hugo, expecting a lot of growth in there as it grows towards Forest Lake, and then in Forest Lake as well. And then on the right-hand side, the employment side, a lot of jobs coming to St. Paul. This is all forecasted in the next 30 years by the Metropolitan Council as well. The need number two is people who rely upon transit. So as the population grows older, with the baby boom now retiring, and even then with the newer members of society, with the millennials, they call them, not really wanting to have a car. They would rather ride transit, bike, or walk. In the last 12 years, and just in this quarter, there was an increase of the elderly population by 1,300 people. Additionally, poverty in the quarter up from over those 12 years by 55% in the whole quarter. The number of people with accessibility to cars continues to grow where they don't have a car, they don't have that accessibility, so they really are transit captive to or getting, you know, walking or taking transit to that. And then also the median household income declined in the corridor by about 11%. So there's really needs for people who really need to use transit. Need number three is the limitations of sustainable travel options in the corridor. You can kind of see the cars on the upper half represent what's on Highway 61. And on the lower half is what's on I-35E. There's traffic volumes in this area are increasing. From 1998 to 2012 on Highway 61, you see a 9% growth just on Highway 61. And similarly, on the 35E, it goes from about 2 million cars per day to about 2.1 million cars per day, about 100,000 growth in there, or 3%. Also, the corridor area commute times on the right-hand side is actually, you see the negative number at the bottom, that's for the 0 to 20 minute commute times. Now you're really looking at, in between 2000 and 2012, a 17% increase on there then too. And lastly, there is increasing demand for transit in the corridor. As you can see on the left-hand side, in downtown St. Paul, going northbound, there's about a 10% increase in demand for northern-oriented routes, whether that's going up to Maplewood, to White Bear Lake, to Hugo, to Forest Lake as well. A little less going on the west side, a negative 3%, and 4% going east and south. And then finally on the right, there is an increase in demand for express and suburban local routes. So this all kind of builds up, all this data really builds up to what are we trying to put into this corridor, what's important, and what are the needs in order to build a transit investment that meets those needs. And if anybody can't hear me, please let me know and I'll continue to try to talk loud. So what comes out of that is really project goals that are support at the development and evaluation of alternatives. So we took what we saw as the needs, and we started to develop these different alternatives, these alignments that you see on the maps here tonight. So this is really what we're looking at. We also looked at what the public was telling us and saying, hey, you really need to look at Highway 61 or White Bear Avenue or Payne or whatever it might be. And then really based on the defined project purpose and need, we now know what kind of investment that we have. What are specific goals are we trying to improve for that investment? So what we did is, along the top there, you can see the four needs that we just spoke about, those project needs, and we have project goals and how they relate to each of those needs. So the first one, I'll just briefly go through this, is really we need to increase the use of transit and its efficiency to attract all users, whether it's somebody who lives in Forest Lake and only wants to take an express bus to downtown in the morning and then come back in the afternoon, in the evening to go home. And for those that are using the bus all day long to shopping, to work, to school, or whatever it might be. We also need to improve sustainable travel options between and within the study area communities. So looking at those different options, not just about cars, but also looking at bikes and pedestrians and transit as well, too. Enhancing the connectivity of the corridor of the regional transportation network. So looking at the Green Line that's now operating, looking at the Gold Line out to Woodbury that's now under study with an environmental impact statement. So connecting that, and then so those are the major lines, and then also looking as you go north, how do you connect to the rest of the transit system in the region as well, too. The fourth is supporting sustainable growth and development patterns that reflect the vision of the local community. So the local communities all the way from St. Paul, all the way north to Forest Lake, they've done a lot of work on what they want their land use plans and their vision to be. So we want to reflect whatever we build to those policies and plans, they have sustainable plans. And that includes the Metropolitan Council as well, who is now has their Thrive 2040 plan as well. Contributing to the improving regional equity and sustainability and quality of life, looking at ways of not only about travel in a car, but looking at all different modes as well into. And then finally, I think one of the most important ones, and that's why we're here tonight, is really developing and selecting an implementable and, most importantly, a community-supported project or projects as we move forward. So these evaluations of alternatives, I kind of went through this on that gumball funnel, is really the tier one. We're looking at transit, mode, and alignment separately. So that's what we're really doing tonight. That's why we kind of separated the modes over there and the alignments over there. We're looking at them, and we're going to be looking at them in a qualitative and some quantitative sense, and trying to say, okay, over the next couple months, what makes sense to set aside, and what makes sense to keep moving forward to the tier two, where we get much more quantitative focused, and we start to pair together the mode and the alignment. So say like on I'll just use an example of Highway 61. What could fit if we have Highway 61 as a alignment? What sort of mode could fit on there, and how would it be impacting that on Highway 61 or White Bear or the trail or whatever it might be? And then tier three, which is that last thing that we do, we refine the alternative, make sure that it's very cost effective to build and do that. You know, what could come out of it, a locally preferred alternative, is just improve the bus system that's out there right now, or it could mean, you know, building a light rail or a bus rapid transit as well. So those are all on the table right now, and that's why on the mode map we have local bus as one of the modes. So we look at here, this is these are the transit modes that we're going to be looking at. They are either rubber tired with the local bus, the arterial rapid transit, similar to what's being built on Snelling Avenue in St. Paul right now. They call it the A-line, that'll be running by the end of this year. Also looking at bus rapid transit on the freeway as well, on I-35E. And then really three rail modes, and you can kind of see what they look like in sort of in scale by over there at the mode table. We're looking at streetcar, we're looking at light rail that everybody knows about, they're now operating on the green line between the cities. And then diesel multiple units, a little bit longer vehicle, but it's being utilized a lot now in other parts of the country than too. So these are the potential transit modes that we're going to be looking at during this tier one. And then also the other potential alignments, the potential alignments for tier one is basically the purple lines and then the blue lines. And you can, I think a lot of people have been seeing that over on the table behind here and then over here. The blue lines represent what we brought out to you in May of last year at the open houses. This was what came out of our 2009 study that made sense. So since then, we've been listening to everybody. We took stuff that we, items that we heard from the open houses. We also talked about what we heard at all the other things, the pop-up meetings, the community events that we've been doing. So we've added this all in there, and you can kind of see from the top the blue line, as I said, the 2009 study, the public engagement, and then we also have for that sort of regional connectivity the green line as it comes down University Avenue and heads towards the Union Depot, and also the gold line, which is coming from Woodbury area, that's bus rapid transit being studied right now, and that goes right to the Union Depot as well. So this is what we're looking at, the universe of alternatives at this point. Next steps, we're here to listen to you tonight. We'd love to talk to you. Anybody with, like Commissioner Reinhart had mentioned, anybody with a name tag would be able to answer any questions. And then also, we'd really like you to fill out the comment sheets. If you did not get that, make sure you get a copy of it, and you can fill it out tonight. And I think as soon as we're done here, I'm going to raise this, and you can see the comment box over. You'll see in a moment behind the screen. Like I mentioned, the next open house, we're not sure what the date yet, but in June we'll be coming out again. It might be in the same different areas. We've been really trying to have different venues as well. And then finally, what we're going to be looking at that is the results of that tier one alternatives analysis. So I really look forward to, we all look forward to talking to you a little bit more one-on-one or in groups around the table at the different boards. If you have questions, feel free to ask anybody with a name tag on.